Welcome to the second lecture in Brown University's Diversity and Inclusion Lecture Series. These are extraordinary times. This is an extraordinary day. And I want to thank all of you for coming this afternoon to be in community with us, to reaffirm the work that we do as institutions, and to ensure that we continue to work together towards the goals that we have put forward around diversity and inclusion here at Brown. And so I thank you for your continued commitment and that you will, in fact, continue to double down on the work, even as we continue to commit to the important work ahead of us. And because this is an extraordinary day, before I introduce our distinguished keynote speaker, I'd like to invite our wonderful provost at Brown, Richard Locke, to come and say a few words and welcome remarks.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's really wonderful to see you, and it's a real distinct pleasure to be able to be here and to hear from one of my heroes, Claude Steele, who was a provost at two different institutions, very, very complicated institutions, and still was able to write this amazing work that I think is really transformative in the way that we understand many things, including stereotype threat. But I just wanted to say a couple things, and it really will be very brief. As Lisa said, this isn't a day like any other day, and I don't want to make this a partisan speech. I think many of us in this room are reeling from the results of the election, and maybe even more than the results of last night, are reeling from probably one of the most divisive, polarizing campaigns, certainly most polarizing campaign that I've ever seen in my adult life. And I think what, and just if you think about it, I mean, so I spend my life trying to understand politics, and I try to understand the results, and I can't make sense totally of the results. But I do know that a very, very long campaign that had pretty hateful rhetoric, and again, I'm not being partisan, there's a lot of that going around in terms of the hatefulness, but basically trying to sort of explain the tensions and problems of our society by blaming the other and whatever the other was, whether it was women or immigrants from certain countries, people of color, people in inner city, a variety of other things, and people of different faiths. And it was really hateful. And I think that that takes a toll, just hearing it, being sort of in one of those categories or in several of those categories and wondering like, wait, why am I being objectified this way? Why am I being portrayed this way? Why does it have to be against me or this category or that category? And it's really, really terrible. And I think that at least for me, that I just feel like it's been a really long period of abuse, and now, you know, what's going to happen next. I think it's anyone's guess, and many of us are worried. But I just want to say two things, at least, that I try to hold on to, or maybe three. The first one is, regardless of the rhetoric and what happened over the last year, and who knows what will happen in the near future, there are a couple things that we can hold on to. And the first thing that we can hold on to is that we are a community here at Brown. And as a community here at Brown, I think we have an obligation to not only take care of ourselves, but to take care of one another. And I think we need to be able to take care of one another right now. I think the community needs that. And so I think that if you're seeing someone who's feeling a little down, please reach out and help them. If you're feeling a little down, then please reach out to someone who can maybe lift you up. It's really important, and it's not going to be just today. It's going to be going on for a while, but this is one of the advantages. The second thing about our community is that notwithstanding all the hateful rhetoric that, again, was going around by many different candidates over the course of the year, there are certain things that we know are true, which is in this community, it's not okay to point out to the other, whatever the other is, whether a person is inner city black youth, Muslim, gay person, a woman, it's not okay to point out to people and use them as the other to justify certain behavior. We have community standards and norms that say we can't do that, we shouldn't do it, it's not the right thing to do. Those community standards and norms are as true today as they were yesterday, and they will be true tomorrow and going forward. So as a community, we just have to uphold those norms, because I think it's not just for us, but because we have to show the world that communities can be diverse, inclusive, respectful, supportive, because that's what this society, what this world needs. And the third thing, and this is just... and the third thing is that at our core, we're an institution of knowledge generation. We teach, we try to learn, we try to do research, and we have to double down on that core. In other words, we have to understand what are these issues that have polarized our society, and not just our society, so many societies, in such a strong way that at least a big chunk of the population feels like the way to understand that is by either pointing to the other or voting a certain way. And again, I'm not trying to be partisan, because I think that there was a lot of negativity going around on all sides here. But that's our job. Our job is to teach and to learn and to do research to try to address some of these great challenges facing our society. Whether those challenges are job creation, wealth creation, a more even distribution of wealth, which is a big issue in this campaign, whether it is to understand differences in our society across gender, race, ethnicity, intersectionality, whatever it is, that's another thing that we do here and that we can do more of. Whatever the issues are, this is a time when the world, our society, our community really needs what we do best. And so what I would encourage us to try to do as a community, and this is regardless of how you voted, is let's come together and support one another, truly support one another. I'm sure I'm like most of you didn't get much sleep last night, but I made sure that I did go exercise this morning, because I know if I don't take care of myself, then I can't take care of others, and then I'll be depleted. So take care of yourselves. It's really important. Take care of one another, and let's double down on what we do best. So thank you. Hang in there. This will be a very, multi-day, multi-month conversation. Thanks.
Thank you, Provost Luck, for those words of support. In the spirit of Rick's remarks, I wonder if we could just take a moment. Many of you are sitting with friends, but I know that there are people here who are here on their own. There are many people who don't know each other. If you could just take a moment and just say hello to someone and introduce yourselves so that people at least know that, you know, we see each other. I think it's an important time to be able to acknowledge all of the humanity that is in this room. So please take a moment and just introduce yourself to someone that you don't yet know. Thank you very much.
Yes, I hope you come back. Oh,
great. My name is Jamal. Nice to meet you. I am from New York. Just me and my mom. My mom's from Jamaica, which is why I wear this thing to signify that.
So for those I haven't yet met, My name is Lisa Cariagolo. I'm the Vice President for Academic Development, Diversity, and Inclusion. I also wanted to just inform you as well that this event is, in fact, being live streamed. And so there are folks out there virtually who may be, as well, listening to our keynote lectures talk today. The purpose and the goal of our University Diversity and Inclusion Lecture Series is to engage and inform us about the research and scholarship which have implications for our work here at Brown on diversity and inclusion. Our hope is that through these lectures we can more critically engage, collectively as a community, in discussions around concerns relevant in our work at Brown to create a more diverse and inclusive academic community. The renowned poet and author, Rowan Ricardo Phillips, 98 AM, 03 PhD, writes in his contribution to the Brown Reader publication, quote, "In the wake of an exhausting first year in the PhD program, I had a renewed sense of why we learn and what an academic institution like Brown can teach us. Not just from the brilliant and smooth surfaces of its known and acknowledged self, but also, importantly, from the folds, fissures, cracks, and sutures of its unknown and unacknowledged self," unquote. He was referring, of course, to the invisible histories of many people at Brown that have at times been overlooked, but are, as we all know, so critically important for us to recover and make visible, because these histories, these narratives, remind us of the essential contributions of so many diverse individuals to sustaining Brown's position as a leading higher education institution nationally and globally. This afternoon's keynote speaker is an individual who has worked tirelessly in the trenches for many years to make such invisible histories and personal narratives known, most notably in his seminal research on stereotype threat and its impact on the learning outcomes for diverse learners in higher education environments. His work as an academic leader and a faculty member over many years has been instrumental in addressing concerns of equity and social justice at many of our leading institutions of higher learning today. Professor Claude M. Steele is currently professor in the Department of Psychology and the Graduate School of Education at UC Berkeley. He most recently served in the role of Executive Vice Chancellor and Provost at UC Berkeley, serving in that role for the past 2 years. Prior to that, he served as the I. James Quillen Dean for the School of Education at Stanford University. And as Dean at Stanford, he led the school towards a deeper engagement in public education. From 2009 to 2011, Provost Steele served as the 21st Provost of Columbia University and led the major initiative there to enhance support for the basic sciences. Before joining Columbia, he was a faculty member at Stanford University, holding many appointments there as the Lucy Stern Professor in the Social Sciences, as well as leading their Center for Advanced Studies in the Behavioral Sciences. He was telling us this afternoon that he was educated at Hiram College and at Ohio State University, where he received his PhD in psychology. Over the next many years, he taught at wide-ranging institutions such as University of Utah, University of Washington, University of Michigan, and the other institutions that I mentioned earlier. But what is most critical to us today is that he is indeed a recognized leader in the field of social psychology. And he is known as well for his commitment to the systematic application of social science to problems of major social significance. Professor Steele's research focuses on the psychological experience of the individual, and particularly on the experiences of threats to the self and the consequences of those threats. His recent book, which I think many of you have read, Whistling Vivaldi, was published in 2010, summarizing years of research on stereotype threat and the factors that influence the underperformance of minority students in higher education. Professor Steele has received numerous fellowships and awards, including election to the National Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Education, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the American Philosophical Society. He's also a member of the board of the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation and the board of the Russell Sage Foundation. In 2012, Professor Steele honored us here at Brown by serving as our distinguished speaker for our annual Martin Luther King Jr. lecture. Please join me in welcoming back Professor Steele to Brown.
Thank you, Lisa, and thank you, Richard. Those are wonderful introductions, and I think they bespeak the mood of all of us and the leadership of this university in its interest in meeting that need and addressing that mood. This is quite a day for everybody. I don't think there's any way of concealing that, and part of it has to do with just the ambiguity of, well, what is to come, and really insignificant, what is to come of efforts like this occasion represents at a university. And so I think it's especially important to hear from the leadership such a heartfelt promise that these concerns, these issues are going to continue to be both a standard of conduct in an institution like this and a mission that this is a community that takes the idea of being an example for all communities seriously and continues that kind of commitment. That is really, I think, an important thing to hear on a day like this. And I think with that kind of commitment, it will happen. So I'm especially gratified to be here and to be part of getting that launched. I do kind of miss being at home on a day like this because the same issues are there, of course. And I was just reading an email before from our chancellor about how we're going to remain committed to these issues. And just to see that people need to write those emails and make these statements on a day like today, I think is an important signal. So sometimes real challenges help galvanize things and motivate people. So let's hope that's the case. I am going to talk today about what I've been increasingly calling the science of diverse communities. And I'd like to build an account of how we can think scientifically, or at least systematically, about making our diverse communities more successful. And by that I mean communities in which people are gratified to be a part of them and feel able to flourish in them. Everybody feels able to flourish in them. How do we make this happen? That will be the central problem of today's talk. I will derive the ideas I'm going to offer from the work on stereotype threat and social identity threat. You know, I'm feeling, if I move around here, can you hear me? I might do that then. It will be derived from thinking that comes out of that work, but I want to apply it to how do you make communities like the ones we aspire to work and be effective for everyone? That's the problem. I want to answer a couple of questions. Why is it important to have communities like this work for everyone? What's at stake? What are the important outcomes we're concerned about? I'm going to go out on a limb and propose what I think it takes to do that, what a community has to aspire to in order to be a place where everybody from multiple backgrounds, multiple identities can flourish, what is the critical ingredient, and then I want to talk about how to do it. How does thinking systematically, drawing on the social sciences, especially social psychology, a little bit of behavioral economics, a little bit, how can you lay out an agenda for constructing such a community? That will be my ambition for the day. I'm going to try to keep my remarks a little shorter than usual, and maybe if you guys remind me, if I go on too long, a little that would help, because especially on a day like today, let's talk. I know everybody wants to talk. We need to, I don't know if the word console each other is the right way to put it. I don't want to be political either, but anyway, I think it's a day where it's important to share our points of view, so I want to give plenty of opportunity for people to do that. I'll talk a little bit about stereotypes yet, just to remind everybody of what that concept, what that is, and then we'll get into these issues around community. Well, a stereotype threat comes from trying to understand a practical problem that I stumbled upon. It is the problem of underperformance, where groups whose abilities are negatively stereotyped in the broader society, even when they are as prepared as other members, as other people in that society, even when they're equally prepared, have the same talent, the same preparation, there tends to be, especially when they're doing difficult, frustrating work, there tends to be this underperformance. I discovered this in relation to African-American students at Michigan initially. Then we found the same thing happened with women in advanced STEM courses at Michigan. And then we found that this was absolutely lawful throughout American society. You can go in almost any integrated classroom or school and find evidence of underperformance of this sort. It's really puzzling because, at least it was especially puzzling to me when I first discovered this, because you'd think if you get two groups equally prepared, skills, everything are the same, then subsequent performance should be the same. Why would at that point one group who's negatively stereotyped be still underperforming in some way when preparation is the same? That's the puzzle. The answer is stereotype threat, at least that's part of the answer. I honestly, as a scientist, believe there are probably some other things in that mix too that may be important. And for you who are interested in working on this kind of problem, there's plenty of opportunities to find other things that may be behind lurking there. I think in a lot of the circumstances that we care about, stereotype threat is a big factor. It's not the only factor. And if you'll remember, stereotype threat is a very simple phenomenon. We came to it trying to understand this underperformance, but as soon as we sort of got it, you realized it's something that everybody experiences in one way or another. It's simply being in a situation or doing something for which a negative stereotype about one of your identities is relevant. As soon as you're in a situation like that, you're doing something now that's important to you, and it turns out that in this society, there is a negative stereotype about people who have a given identity that you have. There's a negative stereotype about that. So you know at that moment that you could be judged or treated, reduced to that stereotype. As I've been saying, with trying to be humorful about it, but not completely, I think a lot about age stereotypes now. These are very powerful stereotypes, and they have huge impacts on our lives, our decision-making, and the sort. You're in a situation where you know you might be seen in terms of an aging stereotype. You're talking about how to turn your television on with your son-in-law, and and you see him reading you as basically incompetent because you just aren't a member of that whatever. So just to give you an example, that's what stereotype threat is just being in a situation. You're doing something. You're going to really feel it if you care about what you're doing. You're going to really feel it if you care if it's important to you. And you know that a stereotype about one of your identities is relevant, then you know you could be judged or treated in terms of that stereotype. And since you care about that, it's very upsetting and distracting and makes you feel very uncomfortable to be in that kind of situation. Stereotype threat can affect a lot of big decisions in life, who becomes our friends, who we marry, what regions of the country we want to live in, what career paths we feel comfortable taking. If the career paths laid out in front of us, we have some interests that might attract us to one, but we feel that when we're in that situation, we're constantly subject to maybe being seen in terms of the stereotype, being reduced to that stereotype. It can be very off-putting, and we might say, well, I'm just going to go and do something else. So stereotype threat can have really profound, it's kind of a social psychological phenomenon, but it can have really very direct concrete effects on our lives, shaping our lives. I think it does shape our lives in ways. In our research, the big question is stereotype threat a powerful enough phenomenon to affect actual intellectual performance, actual school performance? That's the basic question we started with. I often show a videotape here to if you guys have ever heard of the blue-eyed, brown-eyed experiment. Have you ever heard of that, where the teacher comes in one day and stigmatizes blue-eyed kids, and then the next day she comes in and stigmatizes brown-eyed kids, and it's really quite an interesting thing. I recommend going on YouTube. You can see these experiments, and you can see what happened to the kids in the initial experiment, and so on. But one of the interesting things is in the corner of the classroom. As the documentary goes on, it was initially an ABC News documentary. She's working with a problem-solving task with the kids, and she's timing them as to how fast they can go through the deck. And what you see is this dramatic effect when you are a member, when your eye color is stigmatized that way. You are a lot less effective solving these problems, these math problems and these verbal problems. It takes a lot longer to do it than on the day when you're not stigmatized and the other people are stigmatized. On that day, you whiz through the problem deck, feeling very powerful and free. And you're free of judgment. You're free of being judged. You've been sort of granted a status in the situation by result of this stigmatization that she's done in the class, and you feel free and you really move through that deck. So it's I like it because it's a good illustration of how a social status, stigmatized identity, and here she's making up a stigmatized identity around eye color. She's just making it up. How it can nonetheless have pretty direct and powerful effects on the level of cognitive performance. That is a heavy-handed way of doing it. The question we ask is does this happen out in the wild, in everyday life? Let's take, as the first experiment that we did with this idea in mind, let's take women and difficult math. Let's say we don't stand in front of the room and stigmatize women in some direct way, or we don't even subtly expose them to discriminatory cues. Let's just say we give them a difficult test. Would that be enough by itself to cause an underperformance due to stereotype threat? Would that be enough? That's the basic question we ask. The first experiment, for those of you that have read the book, you may remember, it's a very, very simple thing. We just bring women and men who are really good math students. This was done at the University of Michigan. We bring them into the lab one at a time and give them a half-hour section of the graduate record exam you take if you're a math major. Not the general quantitative section, but the really hard math major exam. Half-hour section of that. We know that it's going to cause frustration. That's what we want. They take the test again alone in a room, all by themselves. There's no cues. Nobody said anything to them. If our theory is correct, this would be a very different situation for a woman than for a man. For a man, they would experience that frustration and be upset and maybe worry that they aren't quite as good at math as they thought they were, and they could have doubts and so on. But for a woman, there would be an extra pressure in that situation. The frustration she's experiencing around this test could cue as relevant the negative stereotype in our society about women's math ability. Am I fulfilling that stereotype, or am I going to be seen to fulfill that stereotype? That's an extra worry layered on top of the general frustration in the situation. It should take up more cognitive resources, more mental energies, and their performance should maybe be depleted by that. And when you do that, that's exactly what happens. Big effect. Full standard deviation, women matched perfectly for skills coming into the test, but under that, with that difficult test, they perform about 15 points lower than men do on that test. Well, our colleagues immediately point out that, well, you've just produced evidence that supports the stereotype. That maybe the difference between women and men and their math ability manifests itself when the math is really difficult. And that's where you really start to see this difference, and that's all you've shown here. So we have to come up with an experiment that takes that duplicates that situation, but this time takes the stereotype threat out of it for women, removes the stereotype threat for women. And if it was stereotype threat that was repressing their performance in the first place, and you take it out, their performance should go up to match that of equally skilled men. So after about a year of racking our little brains, we came up with a very simple way of doing this experiment over again, but this time taking the stereotype threat out of it for women math test takers. And it was a simple sentence, we said, before they sat down to take the test. We said it to both the women and the men in this experiment. We said, you may have heard that women don't do as well as men on difficult math tests. You might have heard that. But that's not true for the test you're taking today. For the test you're taking today, women always do as well as men. The subtext of that little sentence is, when you're in the middle of this test and you start to feel frustrated and upset, it has nothing to do with your being a woman. It might have to do with you not being as good at math as you thought you were as an individual, but not because you're a woman, because on this test, women always do as well as men. So with that little sentence, we're able to take out of the situation the stereotype threat that is normally there. And when we do that, thank goodness, women's performance comes up to match that of equally skilled men. It's the same. All of the difference was due to stereotype threat. That's why I'm kind of, you know, cocky about how much stereotype threat explains this underperformance, because the data were pretty dramatic. Then we did the same thing with race. Josh Aronson and I did a bunch of studies, and these were actually the first studies ever published on this work. Somebody else, I think, did a cooler experiment, which I'll quickly tell you about, giving black and white college students an IQ test, the Ravens Progressive Matrices IQ test. It's each item is a square, and there's a design on the square. And then there's five little squares with designs on them, and you have to pick which of the little squares has the same design as the big square. And it starts out easy, and everything is cool, you're flying along, then it starts to get really, really hard and frustrating. And again, it is the frustration that makes the stereotype in our society about the group's abilities relevant as an interpretation of the experience of taking the test. That's what brings it into relevance. If you're not frustrated, you may never think of it, or it may never bother you. I don't think people actually do think about this very consciously. I think it happens sort of semi-consciously, these kind of anxieties. At any rate, if you give it to them, this test, black and white students, and you let them assume it's a test of abilities, it's an IQ test, blacks score 15 points lower than whites, which is exactly the size of the difference between blacks and whites in the general population. You just get that right there. So you, in the lab now, you have recapitulated what you observe in that underperformance I talked about in real life. You get that right there. But in this experiment, this is why I like it so much, you could represent this task not as a test of cognitive abilities, for which the stereotype about blacks' intelligence would be relevant. You could represent this test as not a test at all, but just as a puzzle. It's just a puzzle. We're just working on a puzzle today, and would you try it out for us? And just, you know, do the best you can on this puzzle, but just try it out. So now as you experience frustration, it's frustration with a puzzle. That's why you do puzzles. It's because you want some frustration. You're going to get this thing. And as soon as you do that, the black-white IQ difference goes away. That's the kind of data that gave us confidence that this phenomenon of stereotype threat, this could translate into differences in intellectual performance. Other things as well, the nature of relationships, all kinds of things it could affect. But the interesting initial finding that I think gave the finding some its significance is tying this kind of threat to intellectual performance itself. How does it happen? Think multitasking. You're about to leave to go to a party that you're very happy to go to and you're looking forward to it. Just before you go, you look on your phone and you got some really bad news on the phone. Like, I don't know, if you're an academic, maybe your journal article just got rejected. And you're thinking, those so-and-sos, how could they? And yet you have to go to the party and you have to behave in accord with the norms of that situation. So you're doing two things at once. And you know inside that you're probably not doing either one as well as you could, but you have to get through it. Well, that's I think the experience of stereotype threat is that you're in a situation, could be sitting in a classroom, a seminar room, and you're both trying to pay attention to the work and the discussion that's going on. At the same time, you're worried about how you're going to be seen. How am I going to be seen? And I talk about myself in the book in early graduate school, thinking, well, if I raise my hand and I slip into the South Side of Chicago dialect that is my dialect, what are they going to think of me in this situation? In their eyes, my IQ could drop 50 points right there. That's the kind of. You're worried about that. And this is important to you. That's what makes stereotype threat felt, is that the performance is something that's very important to you. Then the prospect of being seen that way is very upsetting and very cloaking. I mean, it's with you in situations. So, I've been using recently the idea that, kind of like, and this happened to me once, that you come home and somebody says, there's a snake in the house. really? what kind of snake? And how did it get in? And my son did tell me this one time when I came home, that there is a snake in the house. And he saw it go in, and we never ever saw that snake come out. And that created some tense times. I mean, you can't just, you know, kind of flop down and turn on the football game or something with the snake in the house. And a part of your cognitive resources is allocated to, what's that? Why did that move over there? And you're monitoring, you're vigilant. So it's an analogy, it's a metaphor for the experience of, say, being a student and a member of a group whose abilities are negatively stereotyped in our society. What that experience is like, being in a classroom, taking a test, talking to a professor, talking to a TA. Nobody in the room, you can see in the experiments I've just described, you get these effects without, they don't require prejudice or discrimination or ill intent on anybody's part. They're a function of the stereotypes in our society, and the stereotypes in our society are a function of our history. Same person goes to Lagos, Nigeria, and in Lagos, Nigeria, there aren't stereotypes like this about race. Just not there. There may be intense stereotypes around tribal identities, but they're not about race. We went to Poland, and the stereotypes about women and math performance are very weak there. Probably as an aftermath of losing so many men in World War II, women are much more equally represented in all the STEM fields in that society than in our society. So there isn't an evidential basis for a strong gender stereotype about women's math ability in that society, and you don't get very strong stereotype threat effects around math performance. You do get them around other things, but not math performance. So that's just to give you some sense of what I'm talking about. I think as I shift into this thinking about community, there's a couple of points I want to make. One is that what makes you vulnerable to stereotype threat or susceptible to it is not self-doubts, low self-expectations, doubts about your identity. It's not those things. We thought that initially. I talk about this a little bit in the book. I don't think enough, because I think we tend to, that's part of our lay society. If you're affected by a stereotype, it must be triggering an insecurity or a self-doubt in you, and then you're self-fulfilling that self-doubt, and that's how the thing happens. No, that's not the way stereotype threat happens. It's just the opposite, that it are members of the group who are the best at it and the most identified with the area of performance, those are the ones that show stereotype threat the most. because for them, the prospect of being stereotyped in this domain that is very important to them is upsetting and very destabilizing. So it becomes a much more intense problem for them. One thing you can do to reduce the amount of stereotype threat that you're under is to disidentify with the domain. In the case, again, of women in math, you can say, well, look, I'm going to be a journalist, and I'm just not going to worry about this math thing, so it's not as relevant to me. It's too bad that that stereotype's out there and that it may affect my sisters, but it's not my personal problem because I'm not in a world where I am under that pressure. So I can give up caring about that domain as a way of getting out of that pressure in the situation, which is all to say it's the people who care about it. I used to start the talk sometimes with the first few minutes from the movie 8 Mile, which you may remember is the biography of the great white rapper, Eminem. And there's a guy who identified intensely with the domain of performance in which white guys are seen as not very good. There's the critique, you're white with a mic, man. You can't rap. And he's dealing with this stereotype threat as he tries to perform. And there's this dramatic moment where he gets in this duel in front of this huge crowd, and they're going at it, and it's his turn, and he can't say anything. He has to hand over the mic and leave the stage. Well, that's the nature of connecting a social identity to a performance. And these are give you some images of what happens to make that connection. One thing, in moving into this business of community, what makes stereotype threat intense? I've just said it's not so much self-doubts. In fact, it's the people who are strong enough in the area to, like Eminem, who knows he's really good at it. He's got it right there on paper. He knows he's good at it. But it's just the pressure and how you're being seen and the distraction of dealing with that and coping with that. But what does make it strong? Well, it turns out that it is just features of the environment that tell you could be judged in terms of that stereotype, that signal to you that, I've arrived in a situation where I could be seen in terms of that stereotype. Like being one of the only one of your identity in a situation, being the old guy in an audience of listening to music. My son is a musician, I used to go there, and for some reason I would come in and sit down, and I was trying to be really cool, but I would be scanning the room for how many other gray-haired people were in this room. And why would I be doing that? It's just, I don't know, you're just trying to check out, is this identity going to give me any problem here? Or you're just checking it out. So there's a situation where I'm a small minority of a particular identity, and that's a feature of a situation which could make me worry that I would be more likely to be seen in terms of one of these stereotypes. So it comes from features of the environment like that. I start the book out describing my experience as a little kid in Chicago, coming home from school, probably in third grade. I think the first sentence of the book is, this is how I discovered I was black. I may have heard people talk about it, but I don't know, it didn't register with me until we were coming home from school one day, and on the last day of school, we're talking about what we're going to do in the summer, and some guy in the group says, look, we can only go swimming in the pool over there. It's like 3 blocks away in the white neighborhood. We can only go swimming there on Wednesday afternoons. And then we can only go to the roller skate rink on Thursday nights. And this used to be, these were the petty segregations of the society of the 50s and 60s. And it's like, well, who is they and who is we, and why would there be this rule? You don't know the answer to these questions, but you all of a sudden know that this feature about you that you hadn't paid much attention to before is important. And that's how the environment shapes a sense of identity, and it tells you even more than that, that you are going to have to deal with this. You're going to, you can't just decide to ignore this, because the world is organized around that identity in certain ways. So this is one of the first things to understand about our communities, that our communities inherit from our history certain organizations that make these identities give them ongoing significance in our lives. That is a basic reality. If you could just wipe out all the prejudice, we interpret all these things in terms of prejudice of hearts and minds. I want to separate that for a minute. I don't want to argue against that, because I think that's incredibly important. But let's put that over here and say we've gotten all that out of the picture. Still, because of our history, our worlds are organized around these identities, and therefore make these identities something you have to worry about and think about. I can remember doing an intervention program at the University of Michigan, where we had 250 kids in a wing of a dormitory, in the proportions of group proportions of the general population at the University of Michigan. And we were going to show that this is the way you could really do affirmative action. That was sort of the larger purpose of this intervention. I'll talk later about the intervention. But this was just a story that grew out of the intervention itself, just being there. We came in the early days, and we gave students these wonderful lectures about the value of diversity, its centrality to excellence, and they listened and kind of took it in, and we had lots of very interesting and compelling conversations and small groups, and everything was wonderful. And then about 3 weeks into this, I came by at dinner time one night, and I found that all the black kids were left and that were in the cafeteria, and all the white kids were gone. And the white kids were off rushing their fraternities and sororities, and the black kids were left in the cafeteria. And then about a couple weeks later, the reverse happened. The whites were left in the cafeteria, and the blacks were out rushing their fraternities and sororities. Well, there's a piece of organization, the way our institutions, our communities are organized, that reflects our history as a society. And all of the wonderful things that the adults said about not being prejudiced, the value of diversity, all those wonderful things that everybody agreed with. Everybody agreed with them. But down on the ground, there was a fact that told those students, that identity you have, that race, is still going to be very important in your life. It's going to still organize some of the most important things in your life. And you're going to have to deal with it. You're going to have to think about it. You're going to have to understand it. You might even have to defend it. But you're going to have to deal with it. And it's that necessity is growing out of the way the society is organized. And that organization is growing out of a deep history, a history that wouldn't be necessarily the same if we went to another society. African Americans used to love to go to France because France wasn't organized in the same way, and being black didn't mean the same thing, and you kind of felt a certain identity freedom over there that you just didn't feel here. So you were in a place organized around other identities. If you were North African, you were in big trouble in France, but if you were African American, that you were cool. I remember coming in from the airport one of the early times I went there, and this huge 8-story building, on the side of the building was painted a picture of John Coltrane. And I thought, wow, man, France is so... how welcoming could you be that they'd honor, you know, somebody like this? Anyway, you get the picture here, that a lot of the threat around identity isn't so much a threat. I don't want to overstate it. Well, I'll overstate it just to be clear. It isn't so much a threat about prejudice. That's there. But I think a lot of the threat we experience in our environments have to do with the way, with the organizations and the way the American society has been organized and continues to be organized around these identities, which give them significance. Also, think about Yale's problem with the representation of history. That's another dimension of Q that could suggest that an identity might be under some threat. If I have to go to sleep at night in a, what do they call them, colleges, if I have to go to sleep at night in a college named after a slaver, not just a little slaver, but a big slaver. I mean, this guy was like, that was his big thing. He was sort of the Johnny Appleseed of slavery. Why do I have to do this? Well, who's saying it's kind of, and what does this mean if I have to defend that? That's what gives things their significance. I think ideologies we have, ideologies about ability. My colleague Carol Dweck has certainly made this point over and over again. Is the ability it takes to do quantitatively based fields, is that genetically determined in the sense that it's a fixed ability and that by dint of our genes we get a certain amount of it? And if I go into that area and I experience a little frustration, it's a sign that I don't really have the ability? If that ideology about ability, that belief, that understanding of ability is afoot in an environment, then I might well think that. Based on my experience as a woman engaging a STEM course, I might feel like, maybe I don't know what to think here, but maybe this just isn't for me. If you think of ability differently, that ability is actually expandable. And, in Malcolm Gladwell's terms, it's the 10,000-hour rule that we can all get pretty good at things if we put a lot of time and deliberate practice into them. If you think that about the ability it takes to perform well in a STEM field, frustration might mean something very different. It wouldn't have near the threatening impact that it would have if you have this other idea about ability as a fixed and genetically given capacity. So ideologies. If you think of diversity as something that's there for the minority students but isn't of general value, that's another ideology that can give a signal that my identity is maybe in trouble in this environment. I mean, you could make the argument, as I really believe, that the United States, if there is an American exceptionalism, it's because of our diversity, that we've always had more diversity than any other society maybe in the history of the world to draw on, and we've drawn so much from so many different inputs that that's what makes us such a powerful and amazing society, and that even in the most arcane sciences, we were talking about this earlier today. In the most arcane sciences, it's the diversity of perspectives that usually moves problem solving and understanding forward. It's not always some slight increment in skill level. It's often somebody comes in with a very different set of questions, a different set of perspectives that reorganizes everything. So, this is all in the interest of sort of laying out what the challenge for our diverse communities is that we inherit these organizations. There is also plain old prejudice, conscious and unconscious prejudice, hate. And again, as Richard was pointing out, this campaign, part of the disturbing feature of it is that it brings this to light so much that we can't deny we're in a society where where this kind of thing is still afoot. So that too makes a sense of threat in the world, that in our communities. I think that's one way of describing what the cost of it is. This is, I think, in the interest of a fuller grasp of where the threat comes from. It's in these organizations and how we handle history, in the ideologies we have afoot. These sort of almost innocent, sometimes we don't take them for granted, kind of ingredients. So in that instance, what does a community have to have in order to be a place where everybody thrives? I think it has to have something that you can often have in friendships, but it's difficult to get to the same level in institutions, and that is trust. Trust. We just have to trust each other. We have to be able to do that so that we can relax that snake in the house distraction and apprehension and just engage the task at hand and get out of it what is available. That is critical for people taking advantage of the opportunities that are really there. The opportunities are there, but if I think there's a snake in the house, I'm constantly distracted from that. My back is to the opportunities, and it starts to be more toward the snake in the house as a function of all these cues and elements that I'm talking about. And you know, we go through in our society phases where, and this is certainly a phase where this, I think, is characterizes the campuses that we live on. It's enough threat out there that it's not an equal opportunity access that when a woman can just whistle her way into a STEM field course and feel completely comfortable about that there's no other cost to it than to just engage it. No, there is this reality there that I'm trying to describe. So I think trust is a huge thing. And I also like the idea of focusing on communities, because I think it is sort of a unit, a concept that enables us to get practical about building trust. We can't build trust within our part. It's hard to do it for the whole society. It's hard to wipe out our histories. But we can maybe build communities like our university communities, our school communities, where there is a relatively high degree of trust and comfort with each other. And I think a lot of things that do that are in place. We're not starting from scratch. I think we're starting with in many instances with a lot of good elements of community building and community trust already in place. But I'm thinking about how do we really take it that next degree. There are a couple of sort of three avenues I want to go down, and then I want to sort of open it up to questions. I want to. This is all in the direction of how do you do it now? Trust is what we need. Now, how do you build it? I'm going to talk a little bit about the general problem of talking about identity, because I think this is a real challenge in American society. We hate talking about identity. We hate that. Are you going to talk about that again? Oh, God. So I want to talk about that. I've got maybe a practical solution there. Then I want to talk about, well, what can we know from this research about how an individual can cope with identity threat, stereotype threat, and social identity threat of the sort that I'm talking about. What can you do there? There's some very, very interesting ideas coming to light. And then last, how can we make our environments, our social, physical environments, less likely to pose these threats? So these are the three areas I'm going to talk about as to how to go about it, and then we can open it up to questions. Talking about identity. We did the following experiment. White guys, white male college students at Stanford, we brought them into the lab one at a time, and we told them they were going to have a conversation with two other students, and that's what the experiment was about. And they see in front of them two pictures of the two people they're going to have the conversation with. And for some of them, the two pictures are two white guys, and for the other half of them, the two pictures are two black guys. And then they find out that they're going to talk about either love and relationships, which is pretty easy for college students to talk about, we learned, with anybody, or they're going to talk about racial profiling. So they're white guys, and they're going to either talk to two black guys or two white guys, and they're going to talk either about love and relationships or racial profiling. And then we say to them, look, we're going to go down the hall, and I'm going to get your two conversation partners and bring them back for this conversation. By the way, while I'm gone, would you arrange the three chairs for the conversation? And you can imagine us devious social psychologists. As soon as they arrange those three chairs, the experiment's basically over. That's what you're interested in. How do they position themselves vis-a-vis these people as a function of what they're going to talk about? And you can probably predict the results. If they're going to talk to two white guys about anything, they put the three chairs very close together. If they're going to talk to two black guys about love and relationship, they put the three chairs very close together. But if they're going to talk to two black guys, two strangers, about racial profiling, they tend to put the two black guys over here and themselves over here. They demarcate the space in some way. They're not quite in the conversation. And interestingly, we also had their prejudice measured before they were in this experiment. very thoroughly in a different context, unconscious and conscious. And who do you think, when they were going to talk to two black guys about racial profiling, put their chairs farthest away? Was it the least prejudiced or the most prejudiced? Think about all those other stereotype threat experiments. It's the women who are the best at math. It's the African-American students who are the best students. And here, it's the least prejudiced participants put their chairs the farthest away because they care about not being seen as racist. And if they make one mistake here, Jesus, that could happen, and that would just be horrible. So rather than do that, they disengage a little bit. And that's what I think, you know, that's just illustrating what we all kind of intuit at some level, the tension around these difficult, why do we call them difficult dialogues and difficult conversations? Is because they present the opportunity for us to make a little screw up and be seen in a way we would hate to be seen. And that's exactly it. That is white stereotype threat. And white stereotype threat, because of our history, again, is an incredibly powerful form of stereotype threat. The stereotype that whites are racist. So here you have, as a function of our history, whites with their stereotype threat, meeting minorities with their stereotype threat. You got a lot of the tension you got going on there is not because either side is prejudiced necessarily. That could be, but this is a whole different thing. And in a lot of the environments we're talking about, my bet is on this as being the primary thing that makes it uncomfortable. And makes us want to distance ourselves from these discussions and find other ways of explaining everything because we just don't want to go down that path. We don't want to think that's what it is. And our history is just sitting there looming at us, but we're wanting to not see it for these reasons. The costs are too high. Well, here's what we did to get those guys, those white guys, talking to those two black guys about racial profiling, to get them to move their chairs close together. We told them, look, nobody really knows how to have these conversations. These are difficult conversations, standard phrase. You just need to, you know, the best thing to do is treat this as a learning opportunity. Learn. That's your strategy. Learn. And your tactic, ask questions. Just ask questions. When you're in doubt, ask questions. Let your curiosity direct things. And sure enough, when we did that, I mean, I was skeptical. Carol Dweck suggested this to us. I was skeptical. They moved their chairs like right on top of each other. They wanted to talk. They wanted to talk. And this gave them a way of feeling safe from that threat of being seen in terms of that racist stereotype. It's going to be a learning. I don't have to perform being not a racist. And that is really a hard performance. I am not a racist. You have to say the right things, and you have to be confident that you know the right things to say, and that's hard. But to say, I don't know a lot, and I just want to take this opportunity to learn. How do you think about this? Why do you think this? And here's how I react. That's a whole different framing for things, and I think that kind of framing, as a general framing, can be helpful in getting us to start to be more comfortable talking about these things, because nobody really does know how to have these conversations. They are loaded with threat on both sides of it, and probably the best general remedy is to think of them as learning opportunities. That's how Gil Evans got along real well with Miles Davis way back in the day. White guy, square from, you know, Minnesota, comes to New York, and he's going to interact with the super hip Miles Davis, who's kind of mean. and they became the best friends in life because Gil Evans was interested in Miles Davis. Interested. And Miles Davis was interested in him. And interest in somebody is like, whoa, that jumps over a whole lot of boundaries because it's a real big signal that you're not going to see him stereotypically. You're not going to see him that way. You're interested. So I think that set of things can help with the business of having these conversations. What can individuals do? Simple experiment. We're talking about this afternoon. I'll just give it to again really quickly. It's in the book, and maybe some of you guys have read it. You got freshmen at Yale black and white. They hear, I'm going to tell the version in which it's a videotape. They hear a videotape, they see a videotape of another student 18 months ahead of them at Yale. It's a black guy. They're black and white freshmen. They see this videotape. It's like 40 minutes. And the guy's just going on about how he felt when he got to Yale. He felt really estranged and uncomfortable, and even the gargoyles made him feel upset. And he went home on the weekends, and it was, how can I ever fit into that world? That is such a Europhile world. I'll never be comfortable in that world. His father gets mad at him and says, "Well, you got to go back to, man. You know, you're the first in the family to get this opportunity. You got to go back." And so he goes back, and he starts a singing group with his roommate, and they go to department colloquium in sociology and then in biology. And he says, "I just was amazed at how interesting that colloquium was. I didn't know biology could be so interesting. And now I've taken 3 biology courses, and like I'm beginning to think like biology could be, you know, that's where I want to spend my life. I love this stuff. It's so fascinating. And Yale is so amazing because it has so much of it." And on and on. So they have, with this little videotape, implanted into the minds of these freshmen a narrative about their experience there. And the narrative is very clever because it acknowledges the identity-based anxiety that they're having in their first time at Yale. This study was stolen from another study that just did this in general to freshmen, because all freshmen have anxiety. And that video just gave the same storyline, except in this video, it was focused as, because of an African American, I felt this tension. And here's the way I felt it. And here's the degree to which I felt it. So and clinical psychologists make their living by normalizing the anxieties and bad moods that we feel. You go in, "I got this problem, doc," and they pull a book off the shelf and they say, "Well, you got this problem right here," and they give a name to it, and they say, you know, 55% of the population has this at one time or another, and all of a sudden you're feeling better because the problem you got is normal. You're not the only one with the problem. And that's basically what this narrative is doing. It's saying, it's not denying that you shouldn't have this problem, you should relax, everybody here loves you, but it's saying, you got this problem, and everybody, a lot of people have this problem. So you're feeling better, and then there is this whole, light at the end of the tunnel part of the narrative. The second part of the narrative is artful, that you're going to find here that you might find things that you're really interested in, and it would set the course of your life. You could find those here. So that is a very different narrative to go forward with than a narrative that I am under threat. It is unrelenting. It is the structure of the society. It will. That is a very doomy. You know, when I think about parenting, I think that narrative is what parents do. Good parents give you the right narrative. They don't give you a foreclosing, horrible, horrifying narrative. They give you one that tries to acknowledge how you're feeling this way right now, but you're going to feel this way. They tried to do that same kind of talk, and they just did it in an experiment. Well, for the black students, their grades go up 2/3 of a letter grade and in their next semester of their freshman year. And when they are seniors, there is virtually no underperformance for that group of African-American kids randomly assigned to listen to that or see that videotape. That's all the difference was. It starts a positive recursive process. We were talking about that. I feel a little bit less identity threat. The snake is not that big a deal, so I pay attention more to what's in front of me, and I like it, and I start to do a little better. And since I'm doing a little better, I know I'm in better shape. And being in better shape, I have even more attention I can allocate to the work at hand, and you get a very positive cycle going. Whereas underperformance, it turns out, is a negative cycle. It's a negative cycle. Saying, "I don't do very well. Jesus, it must be really terrible and racist here. And I'm so scared now I do even worse. Doing even worse, I worry even more." And then I have an underperformance phenomenon. So that's to give you some sense about that. There are a variety of things that I think affect narratives. You know, again, the ideologies about ability. It's much better to have a narrative that says ability is something that grows than that doesn't. And so on. Last, let me get to things you can do in the environment. Saturate the environment with cues that show interest in diversity. Have as much diversity as you can possibly manage. There's nothing like critical mass. It's like unbelievably important. Role models, existence proofs. You know, Obama's an amazing existence proof. It really does. He doesn't change the racial order, obviously, but it does make it a very different thing to be an African American in a society when you can be the president as opposed to when you can't be the president. So those things make a big difference. There's some more subtle things, but I want to end with this particular notion that I'm getting more and more interested in, and that is, I think our communities need some capacity for reconciliation. And I think if you're going to have a community that is trust, that is built around that, there has to be that. I talked to students earlier today, and I had to say, in the interest of full disclosure, I was raised in a family that was in the 50s and 60s, was deeply into the grip of Martin Luther King and Gandhi and that whole approach to civil rights. And that was a very distinct point of view, which I think we've forgotten for the most part, but it had the following logic. To it. Nonviolence was because you didn't want to be, it would be very hard to build a community with somebody you'd been violent with. So you weren't to be violent, and that allowed for redemption and for reconciliation, for real clear specification of what would be involved in redemption and reconciliation. And reconciliation would lead to a, quote, beloved community. That was the idea, that you would make community with people who had been your enemy at some point, and this is how you had to behave. So there was a whole, you know, it was a paradigm, and the logic went through everything. You showed up at demonstrations with a coat and tie and a dress. That's how you and kids went to these demonstrations. You wanted to show your full humanity, and that would put on display the inhumanity of segregation and racism. That was the genius logic of it, and it was the footage around that, kids being sprayed with fire hoses and police dogs, that really probably mobilized the nation more than anything else about passing those civil rights bills, which were incredibly important. Everything was, as I described earlier, everything was pettily segregated before that. And that went away with that achieved. So that movement achieved that. Now, that all sounds wonderful. There's this passage from Taylor Branch's book it's called Parting the Waters, in which King is walking down the streets of D.C. by himself after Kennedy has been shot. And he's depressed. He's despondent. He hasn't been invited to anything. People treated King, people forget about that now, he's so rarefied. They treated him as a rube, as somebody who, you know, it's like the peaceful kingdom, you know, the lion and the lamb shall frolic together. And what is this country preacher? So he was easily, this whole thing I just outlined, was easy to get cynical about. And the other black leadership immediately or very quickly did get cynical about it. Malcolm's view was, are you kidding? We need justice, man. We don't need any silly beloved community. How's that ever gonna happen? You know, we need some justice. Stokely, so that became the debate, sort of justice versus this reconciliation capacity. Soft, hard, and King's thinking to himself as he walks these streets that I know I'm not going to win this. That the movement is going to go in the other direction. And it did go in the other direction. And when you think about how we think about our communities, which way do we think about it? Well, we certainly think about justice. And in all fairness to King, he thought about justice too. That was a part of reconciliation. You had to have justice before you could reconcile. But it was on the way to reconciliation. Well, I'm beginning to think, just theoretically as a scientist, we need some capacity for reconciliation, or it's just really hard to come together. And it's just hard to make things work. So anyway, that's the story from Lake Wobegon. I'll stop now. If you guys have any questions, if there's time left, good. Then we will, let's have them. Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much for your talk. I had a question that picks up on something very early in the discussion about the blue eye, brown eye thing, and it's something I've wanted to have explained for a long time. It's pretty easy for me to understand why the students whose eye color is stigmatized underperform when they're feeling that pressure. Can you explain, though, why it engenders confidence in the students who are not being stigmatized that day? What is it about someone else doing badly that makes people feel like they're doing well? Because I feel like that's a really important question.
Yeah, that's a very good question, and there is a growing amount of research on that, and the phenomenon is called, we social scientists think up words for everything, so we call that stereotype lift. And the example I might give is a personal one, which I'm an African-American male, and we're very positively stereotyped in basketball. And so I could play basketball as an incompetent for a very long time before that frustration would signal to me that maybe I should do something else. And I'm kind of protected by the general reputation of my group. It's like, I belong here. This is what we do. I belong here. So the fact that I, you know, am bad at it, I'll just get better. So being under the spotlight of a positive group stereotype like that gives you a different relationship to frustration. The frustration doesn't immediately signal that you don't belong on this path of performance. If I'm positively stereotyped in math, maybe I can take more frustration. I can remember doing an experiment in Palo Alto with the junior high school boys and girls, and we gave them a really hard math test that we knew would fail, and then we interviewed them afterwards, and the boys always said things like, well, our teacher never covered that stuff, and you know, my teacher really isn't that good this year, and they kind of like almost whistled out of the room without a lot of big impact. But the girls were like, you know, well, maybe I'm just not that good at math. And it's the stereotype, the general understanding, this is what stereotypes are, of how that ability is distributed based on sex, that makes one person's explanation, that makes people's personal explanations plausible or implausible. So I think that's how you benefit from a positive stereotype. The signal that you don't belong or can't perform is really muted when you're in the group that's positively stereotyped, but when you're in the group that's negatively stereotyped, that signal is amplified, and because it has so much cultural plausibility to it.
Hello, thank you so much for a great presentation. I wanted to ask you what you expect to happen as our society becomes increasingly diverse and the numbers of so-called minorities actually transform into the majorities. How will stereotypes evolve in that kind of context?
Boy, that's a fantastic question, and it's a question everybody has today, of all days. And it's one I have speculated about, because this demographic change is afoot. And in California, we have a lot of it. You know, there are a couple of things that are worrisome. It is the disempowerment of a group of people, a major group of people is involved in this demographic shift. And you hope and worry that people don't balkanize and protect themselves and withdraw their commitment from the public domain. I think I see a little bit of this in California. As California's population, In the 50s and 60s, it was a golden state. The K-12 schools were, you know, 1, 2, 3 in the country. They're now like 48, 49 in the country. The roads were fantastic. The roads are now pretty bad. The universities, the best public university system, I guess I can say this, in the world, was in California. It's an amazing institution. The master plan that goes from community through state universities all the way up to the UC system. But as time went on, and there are more factors than the one I'm going to point to here, but as time went on, and the population became more immigrant-infused, if I can use that term, the commitment to the public domain shrunk. And public institutions that were seen as essential, it was just seen as your right to be able to go to UC Berkeley for free. Now, that day is long gone. And the state doesn't really think it needs to give UC Berkeley any money. Don't get me on a soapbox here. But I do think we're going to have to be frank and open about these challenges of a diverse society, because I think the challenges of that sort are ahead for us. And we certainly need leadership that can manage it, and that's one of the worrisome things here.
Hey, thanks a lot. That was a really great talk. If you have someone who's doing this test in a stereotype situation, and you tell them, hey, there's this phenomenon called stereotype threat, here's kind of how it works. I mean, it's hard to ask it done a specific thing, but hey, there's this phenomenon, stereotype threat, here's kind of how it works, go ahead and do this. How do you think that would change their performance? And if you've done this, does it make them better or worse at this test?
Yeah, people have done exactly that experiment. It helps.
It helps.
It helps. When I first heard about it, I thought, maybe that's just going to double up their anxieties and make them, am I under stereotype threat now, or what is this? And that, there's three snakes out there, But what it does seem to do is normalize the tension. At Stanford, there was a group of undergraduate African-American students who had red T-shirts with the sentence on it, "It's just stereotype threat." I saved those. So I think it normalizes a tension that otherwise people don't have an explanation for, and it really is disturbing then. Yeah.
Man, that's a lot of pressure.
Okay.
As custom, thank you for the talk. But actually, that was a very important point that was helping me thinking about how do you challenge the cognitive dissonance involved then with like a lot of the stereotypes and reconciliation? Because if people want justice, and we say we need justice before reconciliation, and people's notions of justice have like these thoughts behind them that are dissonant and clash, how do you reconcile that? Like, I understand that stereotype threat could help, like acknowledging stereotype threat and spreading this information would address the issues of like subjective tasks and like, promoting people's abilities, but then how do you apply this to like the social sphere where then it's like not a person against a test, it's like a person against a person, if that makes any sense.
And you mean, there's several things I could say there. In the case of person-to-person relationships, for one thing, I want to point out that I think in friendships, cross-group friendships, we do this all the time, and we do it intuitively, that we get to a point, we trust somebody. We trust them, and we know they're not going to see us this way. And I think when I prospered in graduate school is when my advisor and I developed that kind of relationship, and we were friends, kind of just at a friend level. And he would ask my opinion about things. And then that happens that way. So in a social sphere, I think that can happen. But you may be asking about how can you find common terms for justice? And I don't know the answer to that. I think it's hard. but I think one thing you do is start talking about it before you're in a crisis. And you get the community working on that. And getting some terms, getting some common understandings, and then when a crisis happens, you've got some groundwork that people have agreed on. Doing it post hoc, better than nothing, but it's going to be hard that way.
Hi, thank you for that talk. So I wondered if you can explain a little bit how you're disentangling institutions and prejudice, because you mentioned a little while ago that it's more about the institutions than it is prejudice. So I wondered, where do you put institutional racism in that conversation?
Yeah, I tried to signal I don't want to take that comparison too, don't want anybody to take that comparison too seriously, because how do you know? It's prejudice and unconscious bias, which is another kind of phenomenon that I'm very proud my field has really brought to light and has had a huge impact on our public thinking, is profound. So I think it's a really big deal. You hand out an essay and you put a woman's name on it or a man's name on it, you still to this day get the women's essay being graded lower than the man's essay. That's prejudice. That's where a stereotype is affecting how you perceive the value of something. And it's also something that affects how you perceive the value of people and their appropriateness for this role or for that role. This is a person that I should shoot at as opposed to not shooting at. This is a person who's dangerous or not dangerous. So we've got so much evidence these days of that I don't want for a minute to diminish that and say one thing is more important. I was just trying to really make it clear that there are these other sources of identity of threat and pressure on us that we need to understand. And that's what the work is in big part about, is trying to understand what these other sources are, that some of this threat comes from just the way things are organized. When you segregate groups, when you have one group living here and another group living there, that you've laid the groundwork for when a four-year-old sees that, they have to have some account for it. And the account that they come up with is often a prejudicial belief. Well, they're there because they're not, and they, because you're justifying why they're, and that the organization even spawns the prejudicial beliefs that become the source of unconscious and conscious bias later on. If you reorganize the society, you wouldn't have the groundwork for some of the things that go into unconscious, into bias and prejudice. So all I'm trying to do here is not say which one is the most important, but to point to that fact as a huge fact that we hardly ever talk about. We always have the view that any problem in this domain is a problem of prejudice and bias. Well, yes, that's true, but we would have to really begin to rethink how our society is organized to completely get rid of that kind of thing. So that's the point. Thank you.